Welcome.
Great.
Hi, everyone. So we are very lucky today to have Eamonn Store, the CEO of Guardian News Media, Guardian US. And despite his model good looks, it's pronounced Eamonn, not Eamonn. Eamonn, what's unique about you, you really had a strong agency background. To my knowledge, you were at MEC and Starcom for close to 25 years, and maybe even a stint at Caro UK before that. And you sort of sit at the intersection of a lot of issues we're seeing in the publisher community where, let's face it, if you're a publisher in 2016, things can be challenging. We've seen the rise of ad blocking in the past 2 years, issues of transparency and viewability. And when we discussed ad blocking and that being really symptomatic of a larger issue that publishers are facing, I'm curious, you know, what that issue is.
I think part of my experience of being in the agency world is I spent about the last 15 years of my life, or nearly 20 years of my life, trying to simplify things that to clients or to the media was kind of complicated. So whether that's like issues across the world of, I don't know, poison in toothpaste and you've got to get them off the shelves as soon as possible and cancel your campaigns, or dealing with transparency in markets on behalf of the client and how you solve for that, because it's really complicated at the heart of it, but you have to be able to simplify it in a way that's simple English. And for me, ad blocking is really quite a simple human thing. We serve too many ads that aren't very good. We serve them too many times to people that don't want them. And we can't just sit back from that and talk about it as it's like an issue that somehow was suddenly thrust upon us. Right? It's something that we created as an industry. We did it because we're chasing money. We're always chasing the money. We're always chasing the next dollar. But what we don't do is we don't give enough regard to the reader or the viewer. We're always thinking about shareholders or where the money is coming from. And when we look at that, when we look at, you know, you look at ad blocking now, I just think we have to kind of humanize that issue and say, how did we let it happen? How did it become something that was a niche thing, right? A niche thing with in a tech audience. I understand why Wired would have ad blocking, because they have a very smart, techie audience. But how do we let that become a mainstream thing? And we did it because we didn't take the learnings of other media and digital across. We didn't take the best practice. We took, in some senses, the worst. We took the human factor out. Right, so in digital, it's the only space in programmatic where you can place an ad, until recently, without some sort of human factor in checking that. So you can't put an ad on TV, you can't put an ad in print or outdoor or anywhere else without it somehow being vetted and checked and authorized. But because we were chasing high increments or high volume of small incremental money, largely through the programmatic channel, we took that factor out. It meant that as publishers, I believe, we lost control of knowing exactly the quality of what was going on our site, which is where we get bad ads on our site.
And I wanted to drill in there because I think it speaks to some of the issues we've been discussing today, where The Guardian ran into an issue, I think, 6 to 8 months ago, where there were some NRA ads that were showing up on the website and perhaps some unsavory ads. And it really spoke to some of the like contextual challenges that you still see in programmatic sales channels. And I think you said something kind of interesting that we led with, which was, if I didn't work for The Guardian, I would block ads myself. And you know, curious how you mitigated that.
I mean, when I talk about a problem, which, by the way, I think ad blocking is a symptom of a bigger problem. And the bigger problem is a declining lack of trust in media generally from the world at large and news. But if you go back to the ad blocking, the point I was making is not only did we take those factors out of the process, what we then did was we find a situation where where clients or companies are willfully deceiving the process to rename or recalibrate the name of an ad to get around the blacklist that we put in place. We obviously, as a Guardian, have quite strong positions on environment and how we deal with things, how we report around racism, environment, all those things. Our readers come to us for very particular reasons, which is around that quality of journalism. We start feeding them NRA ads. They don't really like it, funnily enough. and we put them first always. But the issue is how did that ad get there in the first place? So when you go back and track that, you see that things are called things like holiday card offer around Christmas time. But it, so if you're the NRA, like, be proud of it and just say you are and name yourself clearly as a client and a media spender. And if you're a particularly bad loans company, stop changing your name to get through our systems, because all you're doing is perpetuating the problem we always have. So a lot of the stuff we do is really exploring how you solve for that. But it's about trying to, again, to humanize the issue and not just layer ad tech on top of ad tech.
And, you know, it comes to mind, you know, one panel we had prior was like quality in the supply chain. And we had a marketer here from Allstate, Carrie Phillips, who said, you know, and this, he threw out a percentage where, you know, the onus is 75% on publishers and 25% on the marketer to really clean up that supply chain. I mean, where does the agency, the publisher, the ad tech vendor, and the marketer, you know, where does that start and end?
I think I would agree. I think that the responsibility is with us as the publisher. Our responsibility, I don't think, is to Allstate or the advertiser. Our responsibility is to our reader first and foremost. I wish that were the case for everyone, but because of the state of the market and how we've driven it, I think that I understand why companies do have such a demand to chase the dollars. But the responsibility is ours. We do really simple things that actually have a really strong effect. We have, for example, one email address in the office, and please don't email it, because there's one guy in here that'll have to answer you all. But if you see a bad ad in The Guardian, you just send it to badads.com. These are bad ads at The Guardian, right? And our team will look at that. So our journalists and all of our commercial team and anyone, when they see a bad ad, just tell us as soon as possible where you saw it, because we can't always guarantee that we'll have picked up already. And we look at it very quickly and we just take it out straight away. We don't look at it and go, but is that client big or how much money do they spend? We just get rid of it because it looks bad. It upsets the reader or certainly the reader experience. And just by doing simple things like that, I think we're able to talk at conferences like this and say, we're not the gold standard, but there is a reason why our ad blocking mobile is less than 0.5%. It's because we don't question where our first priority is, and that is always the reader.
Sure, and I think that's a good segue into this idea of value-based marketing, and I think I heard Andrew Shabir from Essence mention this, but you know, really thinking about tech selection and the partners that you do business with, and I think you made a good anecdote about, you know, sometimes people give more weight to, you know, the life partners they select or the cars they buy than, you know, who they're doing business with. And it goes back to this notion of value-based marketing, as you outlined. I'm curious if you could expand on that.
Yeah. If you thought I was being opinionated, this is where I sort of get on my big high horse and get even more opinionated. But part of this was looking at, part of what we were talking about was looking at the election and going, has the world gone bonkers in America right now? With extremism of politics and from Bernie to Trump and all the crazy stuff that's happening in between. So has the world just gone bonkers this year? And are we in this unique situation of the first kind of mobile election, all these things? And how can we rationalize that aside from the sensationalism of what's going on? Who's to blame? News companies fueling extremism, sensational statements, driving ratings. And you look at that and say, first of all, it's an industry problem. Right, the news companies are chasing the money, the agencies are buying the ratings, and the clients are in it, right, on behalf of the clients. So we can't step back and look at news as an industry as we're in and say it's not, it is just our problem. It's a marketing problem per se. What's more interesting is when you look at the longer term, right, and you go, are we in a crazy year? And when we as The Guardian try and look at that rationally and say, let's just step aside from all the crazy talk and is this just a moment in time, and you start to look at Gallup and Pew and you go back, you realize that we're in a state of a terminal decline of trust in news, as I mentioned earlier. We're now less than, I don't know, overall trust in print media is something like 24% and TV is something like 26%, and digital we have to take as a proxy because you can't measure it over the last 20 years. And that in itself starts to ask a bigger question, which is, have we as an industry as a media, as an industry of agencies and publishers, have we kind of lost our soul a little bit? Have we lost contact with what we're really, why we were really born and what to do? And when you just Google 12 or 14 companies like The Guardian, you do CNN, CNBC, Vice, whatever it is, just Google what are the values of this company? What are the values of CNN? In like something like 8 or 9 examples out of that 12 or 14 you pick, it will take you to a valuation statement. And I just think that's really interesting when you think about it, is what do we stand for as individual companies within an industry? And it makes me reflect, because The Guardian has kind of a very clear set of values. It's sometimes we're so focused on our values, we can't make money, which is kind of part of the fun of what we do. So there's plenty of kind of, okay, that's all well and good being values driven, but you still got to make money. The bit that does make me reflect is I think about 20 plus years in agency world, and I can't remember when I sat down and spent the billions of dollars that we did, I can't remember ever sitting down with a publisher and saying, before we start this conversation, just explain to me what you stand for. What are the values on which you operate? And how do you live those? And I kind of sit here now and I go, why didn't I ever think that? And as an industry, I think we're at a very interesting inflection point where we are in some areas of our business are a race to the bottom. I think the role of agencies is in question in terms of how clients are moving business around in huge amounts of volume. And we're trying to adapt as an industry about how we can trade that and how we trade volume through programmatic. And then what's the added value of the agency? Can they still plan? And what's the value of that planning and how is it? But when you put all of that aside, you sort of look at the conversation with clients and say, if you are these multinational corporate clients and you say you stand for these things that you do, how authentic are you really to that? And how can we explore that in a way that is genuine to those relationships?
Sure, and thinking about, you know, trading and thinking about future trading models, I know you mentioned that in 3 years out, you'd love for The Guardian to be less ad reliant, you know, where if we stay 90% ad reliant as a business model, we won't have a business. And so what are some options for you?
For us in particular, if we don't find new models and options, we don't have a business. So we're pretty clear on that bit. What we do know is we have an extremely loyal, we have a very loyal quality audience, and it's young. We are able to show that quality, we're able to prove to ourselves that quality journalism can attract a young millennial audience as much as an older one. But we can't be ad reliant in 3 years in the model we're in. It just won't work for us. We have to find a metric first of all. We have to be able to quantify what the value of an engaged quality audience means. It's not just about time spent. It needs to be about deeper things than that. I think we have to, in our world, we're making a big bet that we will invest, we have invested in significantly in a much stronger branded content offering in Guardian Labs. It allows us to bring clients into our world, whether trying to retrofit ourselves into an RFP world, which is a something we have to live with, but is not the future of our business. So in the ad world, certainly the area of branded content and that is becoming increasingly important to us. There's some areas of programmatic we can improve on. I think header bidding is a step forward for quality, programmatic quality media, mm-hmm. or inventory. But I think outside of that, we're doing a lot of work exploring what membership means. We understand that a paywall is a very valid option for us. It's not where we've been in our history, and we believe there are other things to explore before that. And membership is a really interesting area to explore. Partnerships commercially in terms of how we build. Is it realistic, knowing the quality of our journalism we deliver every single day, is it realistic for The Guardian to be in a TV format, for example? And if it's not, if it is in any way, it's not about us doing that, right? So who are the right partners to do that? And I guess the thing that I'm kind of really interested in is IP. We tell amazing stories. There's, you know, 3 films, I think the 4th one or 3rd one coming out on Snowden with Oliver Stone in a couple of months. We write these amazing stories. We have such a rich depth of knowledge and expertise around particular subjects. And I don't think we've really learned how to, what the value of that is in our world yet. And if we don't, we need to start to think about this now, because if we don't, in 5-10 years time, we will have left it too late. So I think there are some really, really exciting areas for companies like us in the future. It doesn't walk away from advertising, but I think I would like to think in 3 years' time, I'd like to think that The Guardian might be 50 to 60% ad reliant and not, you know, 90%.
And I wanted to get in one more question because I think we're almost out of time, but thinking about new ad ad as utility, you know, everyone's talking about VR and experiential. You see the New York Times deploying a huge team. Like, what's one of the challenges, you know, for an industry that was so long, you know, looking at the CPM and the CPC to think about quantifying something that's inherently experiential or qualitative?
Two things, I think, if we carry on what we're doing, two things will kill before we get it really going. One is a really good branded or native content. As I think our readers, anyone's readers or viewers are smart enough to know that when you start making this really crass and obvious, it will turn them off really quickly. So I think we have to be really careful. Last year it was all about viewability. This year we can't help talking about ad blocking. Next year we're going to obsess and start beating ourselves up around branded content. The bit that worries me more is VR. I think we're in danger of over-commercializing and doing a lot of damage to VR before we've even got it going. I sat at a conference the other day in another place with a much less reputable company as yourselves. But I literally sat there and listened to three people in a row say how they've absolutely nailed VR, it's going to be brilliant, and they've sold it to X amount of clients in the next X amount of months. And it kind of fills me with dread. Because I think a lot of those clients are going to be trying to explain to their bosses in about 9 to 12 months why they spent X amount of $1 million in VR and why only 300 people had any reaction to it, or something similar. And I would ask you one thing, if any of you have time, is if you, I think VR is a phenomenal storytelling experience. If you have the time and you have a headgear or a cardboard, go and watch 6x9, which is the first thing we did about on VR. It took us a long time. It's about, basically 6x9 is a 9-minute documentary. 6x9 is the measurements of a solitary confinement cell.
Yeah, that's a miss.
We did it because we thought it was a very important story to tell in a country where over 100,000 people are in solitary confinement, which is more than the population in prison of half of Europe. And we basically released it at Tribeca Film Festival. De Niro went and saw it. He couldn't speak afterwards. All he wanted to do was talk on Jimmy Fallon about how that experience was for him. Less than 2 weeks ago, the White House contacted us and asked us if they could work with us on a national campaign, because one of the ambitions of the administration before Obama leaves is at a state level, because it can't be legislated federally, but a state level is to try and put a ban or encourage states to put a ban on juvenile solitary confinement and mental health. That for me is just a really, I'm not sitting here saying I don't feel that we have a privileged purpose in saying this, but I think there are places we have to really, really understand how we, as not just as news companies, but as entertainment, how you can really get the most out of VR, and then think carefully about how you can make that commercially viable. My suspicion is we'll do what we do to everything else. We'll chase the money in the next quarter, we'll tell a great short-term story, and we'll potentially kill these things in the long term before they've had a chance to do justice.
Well, amen. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much.